I'd like to call this meeting of the subcommittee to order. Today we welcome the Chairman of the Board of Governors of the Federal Reserve System for the presentation of the Federal Reserve's Monetary Policy Report to Congress. Since this report was released last week, we, the public and the press, have already had an opportunity to look it over. From what I've seen, general reaction to this report has focused on two issues: the recent alleged easing by the Fed and the indication that the Fed might well undertake a more significant shift in policy if we reach agreement on a major reduction in budget deficits. These issues are certainly important and relevant, and I'll be posing some questions to the chairman about them. At the outset, however, I'd like to call attention to the enduring question we should always be asking the Fed. In October of last year, Chairman Greenspan appeared before this subcommittee to endorse my legislation, H.J. Res. 409, directing the Federal Reserve to eliminate inflation over the next 5 years and then pursue monetary policies that maintain price stability, or zero inflation. Since this legislation has not yet been enacted into law, it is, of course, not yet binding on Fed policy in a legal or formal sense. Nonetheless, Chairman Greenspan has endorsed it, as have the presidents of the Federal Reserve banks. It is a policy which we can and should expect the Fed to pursue, even if it's not yet a legal requirement. It can't be said often enough that the only way to ensure low interest rates is to establish and maintain low or zero inflation. If we would establish and maintain zero inflation, we could expect long-term treasury rates to be 3 or 4%. We could expect short-term rates to be even lower. We could expect mortgage rates at about 6%. We could expect consumer and business rates at about half of today's level. We could significantly reduce the budget deficit by reducing that amount we pay for interest, and we would have established the essential condition for maximum sustained economic growth, maximum sustained employment. We would have established the essential condition for maximum savings and therefore investment, higher productivity in our economy, higher competitiveness in world trade. The one policy of zero inflation gives us essentially the other policies that we want from monetary policy. That being so, the first inquiry we should pose at these hearings on the Fed's monetary policy report is simple. What progress have you made toward zero inflation? Does your outlook for future policy over the next year or so anticipate progress toward zero inflation? What do you see in current economic data and in your forecasts that indicate we will or will not make progress toward zero inflation? If there's been no discernible progress, why not? These are precisely the questions that we'll be asking of the chairman when he's finished his testimony. I will, moreover, want to ask him about the other two issues that seem to dominate this report: the recent so-called credit crunch easing and the relevance of a budget deal for monetary policy, to relate these to our shared long-term goal of eliminating inflation from the American economy. It's always a great pleasure to have the distinguished chairman of the Federal Reserve Board here with us. Before calling on him, however, I would like to ask if there are other members who have opening statements.
I would, Mr. Chairman.
Mr. McCullum.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. Always glad to have you with us, Mr. Greenspan. We have, over the years, gotten to know you and your philosophy and your steady hand down at the Federal Reserve with great respect and admiration. I'm always amazed when you come to these hearings how much attention it not only generates, but if you make one little word one way, the stock market either goes up like that or down like this. And it's just remarkable to me, because it seems to me that you've made your policies so clear to us and they have not deviated to any significant degree that I can determine since we've been holding these hearings. You've been very steady and very forthright in your determination to control inflation and to help guide the other members of the Open Market Committee, who obviously do the voting on all of this, to that end, and to attempt to balance that out with the growth in the economy that we have to have, and all of that in the face of these deficits that we don't control very well up here on the fiscal side of the matter. So I know today you're going to elaborate on some of this and probably follow up with questions that are raised as a result of the last time you talked to a body on a subject like this. But in the long run and over the period that we've known you, we know that it's a very steady course. A lot of work goes into the market, the decisions that are made, a lot of factors to be considered. Our committee will debate sometimes whether you, and not you yourself, but the Open Market Committee perhaps is considering all the right factors at the moment, but these are very big judgment calls. And on the whole, we think that you've done an admirable job of balancing those interests, even if we might disagree from time to time with individual decisions. So we thank you for coming up. Thank you for your patience, and wish you well in juggling all of this as you continue to come before these hearings. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Mr. Barnard.
I have no.
Are there other members who have opening statements? Mr. Neal.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I would hope that, and I want to congratulate you for having Mr. Greenspan here this morning, and certainly the idea that you've broached moving the nation in the direction of 0% inflation is one of the most stimulating that I've witnessed since I've been a member of the House. And I would hope that Mr. Greenspan this morning might speak specifically in his comments to the credit crunch in New England, real or perceived. There are many complaints that I receive, particularly from the small business sector, almost on a daily basis now, about their inability to secure credit. And I would hope that you might have the opportunity this morning, Mr. Greenspan, to speak specifically to that issue. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Are there other members who would like to be recognized at this time? If not, Mr. Chairman, we will put your entire statement in the record and ask that you proceed as you will with your testimony.
Well, thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. When I came before this committee in February, I characterized the economy as poised for continued moderate expansion in 1990, and in large measure, developments so far this year appear to have borne that statement out. There are a number of pluses and minuses in the economic picture by sector and by region, but on balance, the economy still appears to be growing, and the likelihood of a near-term recession seems low. The unemployment rate has remained very low by the standards of the past 20 years, but the rate of increase in wages appears to have leveled out from its earlier upward trend, and the core rate of inflation in consumer prices, which picked up sharply in the first quarter, has moderated in recent months. The June CPI figure, which was boosted by some technical factors, added a note of caution to this assessment, and a continuation of inflation at last month's pace clearly would be very troubling. In 1990, Federal Reserve policy has continued to be directed at sustaining the economic expansion while making progress toward price stability. Ultimately, the two go hand in hand. A stable price level sets the stage for the economy to operate at its peak efficiency, while high inflation inevitably sows the seeds of recession and wrenching readjustment. This year, which has been marked by dramatic changes in the flow of funds through depository institutions, the Federal Reserve has been paying particularly close attention to conditions in credit markets. Evidence of a tightening of terms and reduced availability of credit has gradually accumulated to the point where it became apparent in recent days that some action by the Monetary Authority was warranted. A number of indicators have been pointing in this direction, including the behavior of the monetary aggregates, suggesting that the degree of financial restraint in train might be greater than anticipated or than appropriate to the evolving economic situation. This restraint is a function of developments in the credit markets independent of monetary policy. The recent decline in the federal funds rate to 8% as a consequence of our action to reduce slightly the pressures in reserve markets represents an effort to offset the effects of greater stringency in credit markets. M2 growth slowed sharply over the first half of 1990, owing in some measure to the restructuring of financial flows. Although the closing of insolvent thrifts by the RTC did not directly affect M2, the availability of huge blocks of deposits to the remaining thrifts and banks lessened those institutions' needs to raise rates to draw in funds, contributing to an unusual degree of inertia in the pricing of retail deposits. The link between the RTC's activities and the meager growth this year in the broader monetary aggregate M3 is clearer. The RTC closed down a very large number of SNLs, taking many of those institutions' assets onto the government's balance sheet and thereby effectively reducing the overall funding needs of the depository system. The weakness in the monetary aggregates in part signals a change in the behavior of the depository institutions with potential for affecting overall credit provision. The conservative pricing of retail and wholesale deposits represents one aspect of their efforts to widen profit margins. In light of concerns about their capital positions, banks and thrifts also have reined in lending activity and imposed stiffer terms on loans. The change in credit supply conditions may have significant implications for borrowing, spending, and policy. I would not call this change a credit crunch, as those words connote a contraction of lending on a major scale, with many borrowers effectively shut out of credit markets, regardless of their qualifications. We are not seeing symptoms of that kind of widespread classic crunch, as in the past when deposit rate ceilings or usury ceilings limited the market's ability to adjust and forced cutoffs of credit. But what do we observe? The evidence on this score continues to grow. Numerous reports indicate that depository institutions and other lenders have become more selective in extending credit. The change in credit conditions has taken various forms, including tougher standards for credit approval, higher collateral requirements, increases in interest rates, and in some cases, loans have been simply unavailable. But on some types of credit, including residential mortgages, changes in price and non-price terms appear to have been relatively minor. These types of obligations account for a major share of the credit extended in the economy, and hence the slowing of depository credit and the sluggish behavior of the monetary aggregates, while indicative of some tightening of credit, likely overstate the impact of the depositor's behavior on economic activity. No doubt a sizable portion of lenders' increased reluctance to commit funds for certain purposes reflects a natural and healthy reaction to a slowdown in growth as the economy moves closer to capacity constraints. But there is more to it than that. Through one avenue or another, the change in credit standards has its roots in part in the excesses of the 1980s. Large losses on soured loans and the financial market's distaste for providing additional capital to the institutions taking these losses have interacted with rising capital requirements for banks and thrifts. This interaction has resulted in strong incentives for depository institutions to conserve capital. Partly as a result, the growth of aggregate debt has come down into closer alignment with the expansion of nominal GNP. This process, which reflects a somewhat more cautious approach on the part of borrowers as well, is not an aberrant restrictive phase in the life of the financial system, but rather a return to what had been the norm prior to the 1980s. To be sure, when you go from excess credit creation to normal, it can feel like a tightening. And in that sense, credit conditions have tightened. Many of the loans made during the 1980s should not, by historical standards of creditworthiness, have been made. As standards reverted closer to normal, those weaker borrowers have been finding it far more difficult to access credit. In addition, however, depository institutions appear more recently to be lending with greater caution in general. As a result, even creditworthy borrowers may have to look harder for a loan, put up more collateral, or pay a somewhat higher spread. For the nation as a whole, the tightening of credit standards will leave the financial system on a sounder footing and contribute to economic stability in the long run. Nevertheless, in the here and now, the tightening is beginning to have very real, unwelcome effects. It is difficult to discern the dividing line between lending standards that are still healthy and those that are so restrictive as to be inconsistent with the borrower's status and the best interests of the lender in the long run. In recent weeks, however, we may have slipped over that line. As best we can judge, the change in credit conditions currently is exerting a slight additional degree of restraint on the economy. The process of credit restraint may not have reached completion, and some of its effects may not yet have been felt. Hence, it will require continued scrutiny. However, the tightening should eventually unwind as displaced borrowers find alternate sources of funds and as the banking system rebuilds its capital. At its meeting earlier this month, the Federal Open Market Committee reaffirmed the 1990 range of 3 to 7% it had set for the growth of M2. In view of changing credit flows, a slow rate of expansion in M2 seems consistent with continued moderate growth in output, but any pronounced weakness in the aggregate that drops it below this range might represent greater monetary restraint than is desirable this year. Looking ahead to 1991, the committee lowered the M2 range by a half a percentage point on a provisional basis, consistent with the continuation of measured restraint on aggregate demand, a necessity in the containment and ultimate elimination of inflation. FOMC members and other Reserve Bank presidents generally foresee the policy embodied in the money ranges as leading to both sustained growth and diminished inflation in the period ahead. For 1990, their expectations center on an inflation rate in the 4.5% to 5% range, with real GNP growth of about 1.5% to 2%. But with this year's slow growth helping to relieve pressures on resources, expectations for 1991 incorporate both somewhat lower inflation and somewhat higher real growth at a rate closer to that of growth and potential output. In judging the outlook for the economy over the next year and a half, one source of uncertainty is fiscal policy. But the determination displayed by the Congress and the administration in their efforts to come to an agreement on cutting the deficit has been enormously heartening to all who are concerned about the long-run health of the U.S. economy. As a nation, we have been saving too little and borrowing too much for too long. Significant progress on the federal deficit would be an important step in rectifying this situation. Major, substantive, credible cuts in the budget deficit would present the Federal Reserve with a situation that would call for a careful reconsideration of its policy stance. What adjustment might be necessary and how it might be timed cannot be spelled out before the fact. The actions required will depend on the constellation of other influences on the economy, the nature and magnitude of the fiscal policy package, and the likely timing of its effects. I can only offer the assurance that the Federal Reserve will act, as it has in the past, to endeavor to keep the economy expansion on track. Moreover, concerns that monetary policy would be unable to offset undesirable macroeconomic effects on a budget pact are, I believe, largely unfounded. In the final analysis, a major cut in the budget is unquestionably the right thing to do. It is well past time to reduce the government's draw on credit markets and to free up more resources for enhancing investment and production by the private sector. In this way, fiscal policy, by augmenting national savings, will be doing its part to promote maximum sustainable economic growth. With monetary policy similarly keeping sight of its long-run goal of price stability, the two together will have set a favorable backdrop for vibrant and enduring economic growth. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. You know, I quite agree with you about the need to reduce the budget deficit, and I think everyone does. You see the difficulties that Congress and the administration seems to have with it. I know you've expressed yourself on this point a number of times, but I wonder if you would do it one more time. In your judgment, and the reason I ask you this question, I want to say, is because you have the best economist, I think, that there are around Washington and among the best in the world, and you have lots of them, and I think you're a source of great, can be a source of great economic wisdom for all of us. Now, I want to ask you about, in lowering the budget deficits, I know that you'd prefer cuts on the spend, you would prefer cuts in spending to tax increases, but do you think cutting the budget deficit is so important that we ought to accept some tax increases to do that?
Well, Mr. Chairman, I consider the issue so important that even though there are differences on the economic impact of how one cuts the budget deficit, I think we should be less concerned at this stage with the actual process, so long as it's reasonably balanced, than we should be with the details. I, as I've indicated to this committee many times in the past, would far prefer that the heavy emphasis be on the spending side rather than on the tax side, on the grounds that I think it is a long-term, more credible deficit reduction and one that clearly would endure for a very substantial period into the future. But there's no question, if a budget deficit cut can be made enforceable by the actions which I gather the budget summit are discussing, then I would say we would need to have somewhat less concern about the longer term issue, but I certainly would want to emphasize that the crucial aspect of this budget agreement is that it be credible and enforceable. I mean, if the markets do not respond favorably, they are in effect saying that they do not believe that the deficit package is either credible or enforceable, and I think that the budget summit fully understands that and are working in the appropriate direction.
Now, the stock market, as you know, went down 100 points yesterday and came back up some, but closed down significantly on heavy volume, with the losers outnumbering the gainers significantly. And I've read a number of reports as to why that might have happened. It seems to me, though, that the predominant view is that there are renewed fears of inflation. And as I understand how these markets work, there's probably nothing worse for, again, for high interest rates, for bad market conditions than renewed inflation. And clearly there are some fears, it seems to me clear that there are some fears out there that that's what's going on. And it also seems to me that some of that is being caused by this idea that there's some kind of an agreement that if the Congress administration can significantly reduce budget deficits, that the Fed then is going to ease on the monetary side. Now, I personally think that would be foolish. The idea of reducing budget deficits in terms of the economic benefits occur in terms of increased savings and investment in the private sector, it seems to me. And if the Fed were to offset that by stimulating consumer spending by lowering short-term interest rates, it would seem to me to be very counterproductive. Now, could you comment on that? Take it that if we make some progress on reducing the budget deficit, that that would be a sign for the Fed to start easing in some way, to run the risk of more inflation and
certainly not
stimulating consumer spending?
No, I think that, as I've indicated previously, both to this committee and to your counterparts in the Senate fairly recently, the crucial issue is whether or not this budget cutting exercise is credible and enforceable. And if it is, in my judgment, I think we will see a very significant response in the financial markets. To the extent that that occurs, we would be affected and would respond accordingly. But we would certainly be in the context of not inducing inflationary pressures, because if that were to occur, then the tremendous benefits from the budget cutting exercise would be rapidly dissipated. And we could largely offset the extraordinary benefits, which I see as a consequence, were a policy to be inappropriate to the particular actions that were taken. And in this sense, I think we have to very carefully watch how the markets behave, because it's ultimately market structures that will determine exactly how successful this transition from a very large budget deficit to hopefully something resembling a surplus will materialize. I must say, Mr. Chairman, in answer to the issue which you raised very early on in this hearing before my testimony, we have not changed our view with respect to support of your bill. In fact, looking back, we have put in train a growth in aggregate credit and money supply that, if maintained, will within a few years reach the goals of your proposed bill. Remember also that we are lowering, at least tentatively at the moment, our targets for money supply for M2. And since our effect on inflation is only through the credit markets, I think it's important to observe that we have succeeded really since the October 1987 stock market crash in maintaining a degree of restraint that has brought the three-year moving average of M2 to the lowest level, I believe, in more than three decades. And in fact, it probably goes back to the early 1950s in any prolonged sense. So I would think that with a 5% or less than 5% M2 growth rate, annual rate, we are fairly rapidly approaching the level of monetary expansion which is consistent with long-term price stability. And if we don't fritter away the benefits of the last 2.5 to 3 years, and I can assure you we surely do not intend to do that, then I see no reason to expect other than the achievement of general price stability as we define it over the next several years, so that I see nothing in the actions we are taking in recent days which in any way alters our particular policy path. And I say, you know, look at what we're doing. I mean, it's not an accident that money supply has come down. We have very purposefully, gradually, and in a measured way endeavored to bring the growth rate down. And so far, I think that we have been rather successful.
Well, I think you're moving in the right direction. I want to say in a few words what I think you're saying here, and that is that you're on a course toward, I call it zero inflation, you call it price stability, and that you're not moving from that course, and that that's positive for the economy. And I don't know. The way I read the drop in the stock market yesterday, it's that people have renewed fears of inflation, and I think you're trying to allay some of those fears.
Well, ultimately, Mr. Chairman, inflation is a monetary phenomenon. We have brought the rate of growth in non-financial debt to the lowest level in two decades. And the monetary aggregates related to it, the lowest in three decades. And while I must tell you I'm not actually overly enthusiastic about the price performance to date, as indicated in the charts which you've put around, I think that that is a lagging phenomenon, and what it is important for us to do is to keep a very close eye on making certain that we keep the credit conditions moving towards a non-inflationary environment, because all history tells us that if we stick to that trend, we will achieve success.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. My time has expired, and I'd like to yield to Mr. Barnard this time.
Mr. Chairman, you just said that you were lowering the M2 to targets. Isn't that sort of reactive to what's actually happening, though? I mean, it looks like to me that haven't we had an unusual change in M2 in the last 13 weeks? Is that unusual to what we've experienced?
Yes, it is. And in fact, it's because it's unusual, and in fact, it has dipped below our calculated gradual downward trend. We responded a couple of weeks ago to sort of give it a mid-course correction, so to speak. The slowdown in the 13-week average, which you've got here, is to a substantial, is substantially the result of the resolutions of the SNLs, which, as you may recall, accelerated very substantially during the spring. And as I indicated in my prepared testimony, that had the effect of essentially reducing the growth rate in M2, but it was only part of the change. In other words, it explained only a substantial but not all of the change, and it was the remainder of that change, so to speak, the implied tightening, which we think is occurring currently in the banks and in the thrifts. It's in response to that that we thought that we needed to make the type of adjustment that was appropriate.
Now, the only adjustment you made was in lowering the Fed funds rate, right?
Well, what the purpose? Yes, the effect of that is essentually to try to offset what we perceived as a widening in profit margins in the commercial bank commitments, which tended to create a higher loan level than had previously been existing, and the consequence of that was to contract credit more than we had intended it to do. And the result of that, and so then our actions tends to offset that action as best we can judge.
So by lowering the targets of M2, does that mean that you're going to be lowering the upper range of M2 so that we will not have an unusual increase in M2 at some point in the near future?
That's the meaning of the targets. We have managed to stay over the last several years well within the range of our targets most of the time, and of course have ended up reasonably well within the range over the period of time.
What significance today is M3?
Well, it's clearly of less significance than M2, largely because it has, as a major difference from M2, a very significant amount of funding, purchases of funds, which has created a degree of instability which has, in my judgment, made it a less useful tool than we have found M2, which we find, even with all of its faults, to be, over the long run, an excellent measure of the state of our anti-inflationary posture.
I agree. I think that M3 at some point in time was significant, but I think today in what our initiative should be, that M2 seems to be the best guide to determine where we are going. Mr. Chairman, the Federal Reserve Bank of St. Louis publishes something called the Monetary Trends, and one of the tables published is that for adjusted reserves, which is the adjusted monetary base less currency held by the public. Since February 1987, there has either been a decline in real or actual terms in this number. I'm curious if you attach any importance to this. I'm curious, as it is undoubtedly true that reserve requirements for banks have been increasing over the same period of time.
Well, remember, Congressman, that the reserve balances, to a very substantial extent in recent years, reflect the holdings of demand deposits. And the importance of the reserve balance slowing down is a mirrored reflection in the slowing down in the growth of demand deposits. And as best we can judge from the various surveys which we have taken, there is a structural shift away from demand deposits towards fees. That is, instead of requiring compensating balances, which would be the large, fairly substantial chunk of demand deposits, banks have increasingly gone to direct fees and have eliminated, to an increasing extent, the requirement for compensating balances. The consequence of that has been to slow the growth in demand deposits and therefore significantly slow the growth rate in the monetary, in the reserve base as well.
How is that going to affect Fed decisions on monetary control? Because reserves, Fed has always said that bank reserves was a very important ingredient in the past, it has been an important ingredient in controlling monetary supply. How is that going to, will that have any effect on Fed decisions?
Well, we have obviously incorporated what we observe in the markets and have adjusted our policy and procedures to accommodate what we perceive as the changes which are not material to affecting the financial system at the margin. So obviously it does affect us. We do react to it, but I think we make the appropriate adjustments. At least I've seen no evidence to suggest otherwise.
Time for one more question. Mr. Chairman, it is generally agreed that the U.S. banks are having a difficult time attracting capital. Recent testimony before the Senate indicated that the U.S. commercial banks have almost $600 billion committed to high-risk lending activities composed of LCD debt that has not yet been written off, as well as highly leveraged transactions in commercial real estate loans. Over the last 4 years, absolute charge-offs have totaled $75 billion. Given your near-term view of the economy, can we sustain this level of write-offs? And where will the capital come from to replenish that which is expended? And also, what if there were a recession?
Well, first, Mr. Barnard, I mean, clearly we have seen very significant reserving by the commercial banks. And indeed, the larger banks where the major LDC commitments are have very substantially increased their reserves. And as a consequence, obviously, their primary capital has risen quite appreciably. I testified before the Senate Banking Committee a couple of weeks ago and outlined our view that capital requirements should be gradually raised in time. And one of the reasons, largely, is the notion that we've come off this period of rather significant loan difficulties, and clearly increased capital is a solution not only to loan portfolio and loan quality problems, but also raises some very substantial benefits with respect to the issue of deposit insurance, the threats to the safety net, and the types of subsidies which that safety net creates for the depository institutions. So I should think and hope that we will continue to see accumulation of capital as we move to the 1992 standards required by the Basel Agreement. It strikes me that having gone through the 1980s, I would certainly trust that the 1990s, as they proceed, will show trends in capital ratios of our depository institutions which are up and up sufficiently to ameliorate the types of concerns which your question implies.
Thank you. Mr. Greenspan, you mentioned history in responding to one of my colleague's questions. I would like to ask you a kind of a history question as far as budget symmetry is concerned. Do you have an opinion that if a tax increase is included in any type of budget symmetry agreement, that it will actually reduce the deficit?
It would, Congressman, if, as the members of the budget summit apparently are committed to, enact or make recommendations of means of enforcement. In other words, I think the question of merely putting a budget forecast or a set of budget intentions out from a summit is recognized as not sufficient by those who are engaged in this activity, and they recognize that in order to capture the market's response, that some budget process structural changes that will cement or create credibility for the long-term budget agreement must be part of the package.
Can I go back to 1982 when TEFRA was passed, when there was a budget agreement that for every tax dollar that was increased in that increase that was passed, that there would be $3 of spending reductions?
And, of course, the dollar of tax increase was passed, and we are still waiting presently to get 1 cent of those spending reductions. In other words, that type of an agreement would not be one that you would be in favor of.
Well, whether I would be in favor or not, well, I don't think is relevant. I think
what it is relevant in this committee.
Well,
right
no,
now.
I think what is relevant is whether the markets would react favorably to an agreement which didn't have some form of enforcement mechanism in it. My judgment is that the market would not.
It would not. Let me refer to your prior statement about credit crunch. You said that you didn't feel that there was a credit crunch of sorts in our economy presently.
Yeah, that's. I must admit it's a semantic issue, and there are those who are sitting out there with great difficulty obtaining financing who would find the nicety of my language rather inappropriate. But in a technical sense, credit crunch is really more applicable to what happened when, in years past, we used to have ceilings on depository interest rates from Reg Q, for example, and ran into massive disintermediation with immediate impact on the economy. That is not what we're having today, and I think it's better described in terms, as I put it, as a tightening in the market as a result of depository institutions in an endeavor to preserve their capital position, pulling back more than would be involved in the normal interrelationship between money market conditions and commercial bank activities.
But wouldn't that, or isn't that a direct effect of the scrutiny of the regulators or the people that are out there overseeing the banks, the thrifts, and other lending institutions?
It's very difficult to disentangle some of the motives. I think there are certain things which have got to be evident. As I've said to this committee previously, the fact that there are a number of banks that have gone through a period of what is clearly, in retrospect, lax lending standards, it is virtually inevitable, unless human nature has been repealed, for them to be pulling back and be cautious. Similarly, the examiners who were involved in that same process, and in retrospect have had to have had the same reaction, are invariably more cautious. Now, I'm saying that that is not necessarily bad. Most of that, in fact, in most cases, I think it's good, not bad. The one issue which I raise is that I think in recent weeks the evidence suggests that we tilted, that the degree of tightening has gone perhaps a little bit more towards the undesirable than it had been. And I would certainly not say, as far as I can judge, talking with the controller of the currency, with the head of the FDIC, with my colleagues at the Fed, I see no evidence of any policy stance on the regulator's part to tighten up in a manner which creates the phenomenon we are looking at. I think it is largely a response to the lax standards that existed, and to me, I would not want to say that I have any really firm evidence which suggests that, other than the normal psychological reaction that every human being would have, whether he's a banker or an examiner, I don't see anything which suggests to me that there's any program, or certainly no policy, which would endeavor to create what other people have called crunch.
Well, my time has almost expired, but I disagree because in dealing with those that have legitimate borrowing needs and have been very successful businessmen, they are running into a brick wall on a daily basis trying to go out and borrow money to finance legitimate enterprises in this economy.
No, from the as a result of the regulators?
As a result of those overseeing banks and regulators and those banks reacting to those people who have come in.
Well, Congressman, I don't disagree with some of the conclusions that you're reaching with respect to what some customers of banks are having. I think the cause of the problem, however, is somewhat more complex than merely the regulators putting pressure on the banks. I think that their own capital positions and their own awarenesses of the best the actions required for purposes of maintaining safety and soundness has induced those actions wholly independently of what the examiners have done. In fact, I would be inclined to say that the vast majority of the actions are initiated, in my judgment, appropriately by the commercial banks themselves, independent of actions taken by the examiners.
Mr. Hoagland.
Well, it's certainly a pleasure, Mr. Chairman, to have you before the committee again today, and I'd like to join the chairman and my colleagues in welcoming you and on congratulating you for your steady hand and for the fine job that you've done. In order to help us read your crystal ball a little bit more clearly, I'd like to ask you a question about the importance of the various variables to you and the decision-making of you and your colleagues. One can construct multiple scenarios for the U.S. economy using different combinations of the kind of variables you've discussed today. Most importantly, inflation rate and economic growth rate. What combinations of real growth and inflation are likely to lead to easing, steady, or tightening monetary policy? For example, would you ease if real GNP growth slowed to under 1% as long as inflation were under 5%. Conversely, if inflation fell in the 3.5 to 4% range, would you be willing to ease even if the GNP growth rate were around 2%? In other words, what are the critical thresholds for your priority variable?
Well, the problems are, I think, requiring far more detailed evidence than just the hypotheticals which you suggested. And I would also want to mention that there are slightly different priorities amongst the members of the FOMC, but I would say, in general, we have the basic view that there is no trade-off, in a sense, between inflation and real growth. It's not sort of how does one balance those things, because I think that we are all pretty much committed, as I've indicated here numerous times in the past, to the proposition that a necessary condition for sustaining long-term growth is a non-inflationary environment, and that in fact the quickest way to induce a recession, if one were really trying to do that, would be allow inflation to accelerate, because it would surely undercut the economy very rapidly, and the instabilities that would occur as a consequence of that would create the type of economic contraction which would be very difficult to deal with. I don't want to respond to your question in the detail that you give it to me, not only because it's, I think, they're hypothetical issues, but I do think we don't have a simple rule which I could infer by polling the FOMC in a manner which would be responsive to your question.
But it sounds from your answer as if the most equal of all of the variables is inflation, and that what the inflation rate is the first variable that you look to.
Well,
is that fair?
In an odd way, we really look at credit conditions first, because that's an earlier version of the inflationary process. Often when we see the effects in the price levels, the published price levels, that's a historical fact, and we may look at a period in which the published inflation rates are rather low for a protracted period. But if we are in the process of rapidly expanding credit in this country, and the money supply is moving at a pace which is inconsistent with the recently historical level of prices, what history tells us is it's just a matter of time before inflation, the published statistics, begin to rise. So in many respects, the elements of the published growth rates in the GNP and the inflation rates are history. They tell us where we have been. But of necessity, monetary policy must be forward-looking, whether we like it or not. Because if we tend to react to the data of the past, we will whipsaw the credit markets inevitably. And it's that process which we try as best we can. And we recognize that it's not easy. We try to maintain a degree of stability consistent with long-term price stability on the grounds that that's the best way to get long-term stable economic growth, stable exchange rates, stable financial elements of all types. And it's the type of economy which is the most efficient and is most likely to have the most the highest degree of productivity growth.
Let me ask you a question on another subject. Mr. Chairman, there's concern in business and economic forecasting circles about the quality of economic statistics prepared by the government, which are used for planning in the economy. Revisions are often substantial and cause reasonable men to radically alter their assumptions about the future. What statistics do you feel are the most timely and accurate for capturing how the overall economy is performing at the margin? And if you could see only three numbers each week, why, which would they be?
Mr. Hoglett, I would suspect that I would choose three, and then 3 weeks later I would decide I needed a fourth. I think it is true that at any particular time there are only a few very important variables which you look at. The trouble is that that continues to change, and the reason it changes is that at the margin, where the economy is changing and where the forces of strength and weakness are continually altering. And so what you do is you find yourself continuously shifting what you're watching and what you're looking at. And as a consequence, while it is true there are only relatively few key indicators at any time, I think you'll find that over a year's time, that what years time that what those particular key indicators were have probably changed three or four times.
Well, is there anything the U.S. should do, Mr. Chairman, to improve the quality of our economic statistic reporting? Should we sacrifice timeliness, for instance, for more accuracy, as some analysts have suggested?
That's a very difficult decision. I think it really gets to the question of how we use the numbers and how we adjust in our own minds what we know to be their degree of inaccuracy. I think it varies, frankly, with the individual analysts. I myself prefer early data, even though it is to a large extent inaccurate in any exact sense, because I think the order of magnitude of what's happening can usually be picked up by advanced data, even if they are substantially revised. I find that even after the revision, your initial judgment as to what it signifies does not materially change, although in a statistical sense it looks like a major revision. It's very important, for example, to know whether a figure is going up or going down. It's far more important than how much it's going up or how much it's going down. And it's that type of gross judgment which is crucial to policymaking, which requires that we have timeliness even at the expense, if necessary, significant subsequent revisions.
Well, my time is up, Mr. Chairman. Thank you very much for your time.
Mr. Licht. Tom's not a member of the subcommittee. If you want to, you.
No.
I'm not. I'd be happy to.
Mr. Ridge. Oh. Thank you.
Good morning, Mr. Chairman. I want to just follow on very briefly some of the observations made by my colleague, Mr. Bunning, with regard to your assessment of the tightening of credit. In discussing this matter with many financial leaders in Pennsylvania, there is a sense, at least in my mind, that there are a variety of factors that have been involved in what appears to be a voluntary, somewhat of a voluntary restriction of credit. There's a whole psychology that follows after FIREA. There is a psychology of the auditors coming in and taking a look at the books and assessing loans more critically than they've done before. There's a move to get to the 1992 capital standards, and we want them to continue to move in that direction. I think there's an institution-by-institution decision to, in recognition that maybe they were a little lax in the 80s, and they do have to tighten. The bottom line is there anything that you've seen that would suggest that all of these have resulted in an overreaction? Or do you see that this restriction of credit, and I think it's out there, this contraction of credit that has nothing to do with its availability? I mean, there's money to be lent. It just seems to many of us that the institutions are more reluctant to do so. Is there any concern that you have that there's been an overreaction in this regard?
Up until fairly recently, there wasn't. But as I've indicated in my prepared testimony, I think we may have gone over the line on that. And I do think, from the evidence which seems to be accumulating of late, that the answer to your question is partly yes.
And what initiatives, what countermeasures, what do we do to get it back into balance?
Well, the first thing I think that we chose to do was to see whether we could offset the negative effects in the money markets that occur as a consequence of that, the pulling back, by easing slightly, as we did a short while ago, which is an offsetting action for purposes of trying to at least offset the credit stringency implications of going too far. Aside from that, there's not very much that one can do, because what you are dealing with is human nature and human psychology. And you have to ask yourself, if you were a commercial banker or a thrift executive sitting in today's environment after what has occurred, would you be more inclined to be cautious than otherwise? And the answer to that has invariably got to be yes. Now, short of confronting that problem, there's not very much we can do except to try to create an environment in which the economy is in a healthy state, that the
customers of the depository institutions are clearly creditworthy and have sensible projects, because it's only a matter of time before the trauma of the 80s will wear off. And the reason that will wear off is that if there is an overreaction on the part, say, of a commercial banker who is pulling back more than he really should, he's going to find that one of his competitors is going to move in there and take over that business. The balancing of risks is what banking is all about. And if you overdo it, you'll go belly up. But if you are too restrictive, you will be out of business as well.
Mr. Chairman, I want to just shift gears just a little bit. If we can do something significant, you call it credible and enforceable, in terms of reducing our deficit and reducing the governmental component in the aggregate economy, then clearly we want to stimulate private consumption, private investment, and net exports. And exports have been an increasingly significant factor, I think, in economic growth, particularly over the past two or three years. Would you agree that the continued improvement in our nation's ability to export goods and services is a necessary component of the transition from a reduced government component to the private sector component? And would you have any specific recommendations to accelerate export promotion?
Well, Congressman, I wouldn't say it is a necessary condition, but there's no doubt it is a very important element in that transition. And indeed, one of the reasons why the economy, which is rather sluggish, obviously, currently, is still growing, is the export order pattern. In other words, if we look at the structure of manufacturing orders, it's fairly clear that the share of export orders in the total continues to rise, and that it is supporting what is a very sluggish order pattern, and it continues to be a factor which I think continues to move us forward. I'm not sure we have to go through export promotion in the government-sponsored sense, but I do think that we have observed an increasing propensity to look at foreign markets on the part of U.S. manufacturers, who have clearly become more competitive in recent years and capable of dealing with those markets in an increasingly impressive way. Would I like to see it expand much further? The answer is most certainly yes. And I think that if we are able to significantly improve or continue to improve our export competitiveness, I think that it'll be a very important element in economic growth in this country.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Neal.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Greenspan, you spoke appropriately to the credit crunch questions that I had raised earlier, and I think as follow-up to what Mr. Bunning and to Mr. Ridge has suggested this morning, that in New England there is a perceived credit crunch. And it seems to me that the small business person is the individual who's really getting hurt at the moment. And I think that you can see that in an overreaction from the banking community, which has contributed to a significant downturn in the New England economy. Mr. Butterfield's piece on the front page of the New York Times yesterday, I think, spoke eloquently to that issue. Maybe you could give us a synopsis of what you think has gone wrong with the New England economy.
Well, Mr. Neal, I think that it's important to look at different regions in the country. There's no question that New England is under significant stringency with respect to its overall economy. from what was clearly a booming economy for a number of years, the rate of growth first slipped very dramatically, and now it's clearly in some difficulty. We are aware of that and have been monitoring it in some considerable detail. The hotline up in Boston has been, I think, useful. We have to recognize that a very substantial part of the contraction in credit availability is reflective of the weakness in the economy itself. It's a decline in demand. And so what we're observing in the issue of softness is to a large extent the economic structure of New England. Nonetheless, I do think it's important to emphasize that the underlying structure of New England remains healthy. I mean, it's a competitive, it's a strong competitive environment, and I think that this is an adjustment process which will take a while to get through. It is clearly, it is very difficult, and I think a number of people are in trouble. But it's nothing, as I see, that is fundamental to the structure of the New England economy that strikes me as suggesting that this is other than a temporary phenomenon.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Leach.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. One question about the budget, Mr. Chairman. The Fed has taken a risk, kind of an invitation to Congress, and just slightly lowering interest rates in anticipation that Congress might have a successful budget conference with the executive branch.
Let me just interrupt. That is not the reason for our action, Mr. Leach. I mean, the reason basically is that we're endeavoring to offset what we perceive of as independent tightening in the markets by the depository institutions, and we in no way
are inviting
even
Congress.
Remotely contemplated that action in any way associated with the budget.
I stand corrected. I think it's always presumptuous to apply motives to someone else, and so you are the only one that knows your own motives, and your assertions must obviously be correct, so I apologize. But can you tell us what happens if there's no budget agreement and or if Congress fails to put in place an agreement that the leadership of Congress may negotiate with the executive branch? Would you say interest rates are likely to go up? Would you say there'll be a shaking in confidence in the economy? Can you tell us what your judgment is on that?
Mr. Leach, I wish I could give you an exact scenario of what would happen. I can't, because I frankly don't know. But it is not fraught with benevolent events.
Are you, just to flesh this out a bit, non-benevolence is an interesting thought, but it would be a danger to the economy, would you say?
I would say that we should not risk failure in this respect.
Well, I'd like to flesh that further, but I think you'd rather I wouldn't. So let me just move to a couple of comments you made earlier in response to questions flock a horse that maybe I've flocked too often. You noted that banks have moved on their own to reserve certain things unrelated to what regulators might have insisted upon, and kind of a self-regulatory effort in commercial banking. Let me just say that I don't take enormous solace in that fact, although I must say that the Fed has helped instigate some leadership in this area. But let me just make four or five quick observations.
with some exceptions, most of the larger banks have not reserved their foreign losses to levels of their foreign loans to levels that the secondary market values those loans, and they haven't reserved them to levels that outside observers like Moody's or the GAO have suggested would be appropriate. Secondly, a portion of these reserves can be used of the loan losses can be counted as capital, although Tier 2. Now, maybe in an instance or two like Morgan, this is appropriate. But the fact is, for most banks, that defies common sense. Thirdly, the lesson of the thrift debacle was that the only prudent curtailment of excessive growth is adequate capital ratios based, and here I would stress, on prudent accounting. Because it begins with counting what your capital ratios are. And if one hasn't reserved appropriately, by some sort of self-definition, one can have excessive growth. And I would like to just stress here for a second, both in relationship to the thrift issue as well as the LDC issue, that when you have different standards between kinds of institutions, you impel growth in the institutions with the weaker standards. That's what we had with the thrifts. When you have different standards between states that are weaker, you impel growth in the weaker regulated states. And when you have different standards between kinds of similar institutions, in this case between one kind of bank and another kind of bank, you impel growth towards those kinds of banks. And it strikes me that with as the fourth point, that one of the lessons of the LDC misjudgment is, if anything, that bigness deserves tougher appraisal than smallness. And if you remember in the late 70s, every major bank testified that because the breadth of their loan portfolios, because of sovereign guarantees, they were in a more prudential position to leverage capital than smaller institutions. It strikes me, if you look at the economy, job growth is in small business, not big. Small business relates to small banks rather than large. And you can attach a little easier 100 acres of Iowa farmland than you can Brazil. And so, if anything, the case at a minimum for comparable standards between big banks and small banks seems to me appropriate. And I think quite rationally, someone might argue as they look at the rationalizations for big banks' existence to begin with, having changed dramatically in the last decade, that one might say that big banks ought to have tougher capital standards than small because they're more dangerous entities to run. And so all I would ask at this time is that it strikes me that what we need is not just a Basel Accord where we see the lowest common denominator for foreign kinds of standards applied, but maybe a Des Moines Accord where we apply Iowa internal standards to commercial banking instead of foreign. If you did that, you would find the banking system propelled towards a little higher capital ratio of a Tier 1 capital nature instead of what I think is going to become internally a race to have capital standards erode a bit from those banks that are more prudentially regulated in the domestic banking system, particularly in rural states, whereas the larger banks may come under a little greater pressure to upgrade. And what all I'm suggesting is, can you give us a little more definitively the direction the Fed is going to take with regard to capital ratios?
Well, Mr. Leach, we are obviously looking at this whole question in some considerable detail. And indeed, it is our increasing awareness that capital solves a lot of problems that has led us to the conclusion that it would be useful over time to have equity asset and capital asset ratios generally moving upward. The risk-based standards which are embodied in the Basel Accord do come to grips with some of the issues you raise, the Iowa standard versus the international standard. And I think we're all acutely aware that the mix of assets and liabilities and the collateral underlying them are clearly quite crucial to the issue of what capital requirements should be. And while we don't believe that the Basel Accord at this particular point encompasses all of the risks that we ultimately would like to monitor, I mean, for example, interest rate risk is not there. It is a major advance in getting sensible standards.
Well, I concur, and I don't want to take more time, Mr. Chairman. In fact, it's up, but if I could comment for 10 seconds. I think it is a step forward, but whether or not it's a sufficient step, one might have some questions, and it's based upon definition. And if banks can self-define their levels of reserves, then they have the capacity to say they meet a given, let's say, 4% Tier 1 capital leveraging ratio. But if that self-definition is less than every prudent outside observer thinks is honest accounting, then one of the interesting questions you have is whether you have accounting gimmickry, certainly not to the degree that occurred in the thrift industry, but to a degree that warrants attention. And I think it has to be considered the responsibility of the regulators to assess consistent accounting practices. And in that regard, everything begins with numbers. And I just hope that, that there's concern in whether, I mean, I think the Basel Accords are a great first step. Whether they should be considered an intermediate or final step is another issue. And secondly, what the numbers or what the accounting practices that go into the numbers is very important.
No, I would agree with that, Mr. Leach. And in fact, while it is certainly the case that each individual bank sets its own reserves and its own reserve standards, examiners do oversee what is being done and is part of the examination process. I mean, there are reasons in certain instances. They may be incorrect, but it's not just arbitrary that in some cases reserves for particular LDC loans do not seem in any way close to the discounted value of some of those related assets in the secondary markets. And I think the reason in many respects is that the individual institution does not envisage itself as having loans that are short-term investments that will be rapidly turned over, but rather looks at their commitment in a particular geographical area or country as of a permanent type, and do not think it is appropriate to write down to the particular marginal market value of all of its assets to get an appropriate view of what the portfolio is actually worth, in the same manner that individual bankers on domestic loans don't evaluate each individual loan to a long-term customer by market changes, which could be the result of market interest rates or other things, but they look at it over a longer-term time frame. Nonetheless, it is certainly required of, and indeed examiners do look closely at the reasons why reserves are set as they are. And as you know, in the ICURT process, there is actually mandated write-offs in certain instances.
I want to recognize Mr. Schumer at this time. Let me say, I didn't say a little earlier that I want to welcome several members of the full banking committee who are not members of this subcommittee. I don't know which Mr. Schumer this is. I think there must be at least three Mr. Schumers in the Congress, because I don't think I've ever known anyone so hardworking and active on so many subjects. So anyway, Chuck, you're welcome, and I recognize you
I don't know if I should say anything and screw it all up now, huh? Thank you, Steve. And thank you, Mr. Chairman. Once again, your testimony is welcome, and you're getting very, very good at the art of testifying before Congress, walking all those little tight ropes. I guess you can judge it by the number of people who rush out of the room after you said something. I take it that wasn't because they served a bad breakfast or something this morning. Anyway, on the weakness of the economy, you said last week that we were a shade more, those are your words, in the direction of recession. And my question relates to the fact about the depth of a recession if it should occur. Given the S&L crisis, the problems in the banking industry, the greater leverage that our companies have, that our corporations have, do we have to worry that if we were, unfortunately, to go into recession, that it would be a deeper and stronger recession than one that we have known in a long time, particularly in financial services and led by financial services? Let me start with that.
Mr. Schumer, that's very difficult to judge. I think we know several things. We know that in the past, specifically in the post-World War II period, that recessions were to a large extent inventory recessions.
Right.
And that in recent years there has been unquestionably been significant increasing management of inventories to the point while at the moment there are very modest areas of excess in general, there is not. And in addition, an increasing part of our inventories that we hold are imported goods rather than domestically produced goods, which means that to the extent that there are inventory corrections, they are backed out of both imports and production. So I would say at the moment, even though we have a very sluggish economy, and it is really quite soft,
right,
as we've seen in the last 6 months or so, the inventory imbalances do not seem to have arisen, which suggest, as they often did in the past, the beginnings of a tiltover. This suggests that if we are to have a recession, or if a recession takes place, and clearly we at the Federal Reserve are not seeking that because we don't believe it serves any useful purpose, but there are markets out there and there are, there's nothing out that I can imagine which has said that we have somehow repealed the business cycle. So in the event that we do have a recession, it's clearly going to be a somewhat different type. And I'm not sure that one can reasonably make judgments as to what the nature of it is, since we haven't really observed that sort of phenomenon in recent decades.
Well, does it mean that we should perhaps be a little more careful, given that there's sort of the unknown out there, and given these other factors, which do trouble me significantly, the weakness in the financial sector, the over-leveraging, all the effects of the 80s, should we be a little more careful than we otherwise would be in avoiding recession because of the potential unknown or the potential depth of it?
I'm not sure how one does that. In other words, as I indicated to you on many occasions and here earlier, I'm not sure whether the answer so far as monetary policy to right. that solution is whether you tighten or whether you ease.
Right.
I think that what we have done, and I think is certainly quite helpful, is that we have brought the rate of growth in credit and money supply down quite significantly from its high points several years ago, and the best thing that we can do to insulate the economy from the excesses and the imbalances of the past is to try to create an environment in which what you've got is a less dramatic growth in credit, more caution, because having said, as I've said to your colleagues here, that the contraction of credit has been a problem for a lot of people, a substantial part of that contraction in the rate of growth is healthy. And in fact, I think buttresses the financial system and alleviates some of the distortions that clearly exist and the types of problems which are creating, which you find worrisome, and so do I.
Okay. You know, there is a lot of speculation that if we come to a budget agreement because of the squishiness of the economy, that we ought not to reduce the deficit by too much and hence perversely plunge the country into recession. I guess we're in the same situation that you are. You don't know how much is enough, et cetera. There has been speculation, I've heard it from various people, various parties, that we ought not to reduce the deficit, whether by revenues or by cuts, more than, say, $50 billion, even if that means we have to revise the Graham-Rudman targets upward. What's your view? Is there a limit to how much we should cut?
There is a limit, Mr. Schumer.
Is $50 billion appropriate amount?
Yeah, $50 to $60 billion, as best we can judge, is handleable. I think we have to be very careful, however, to allow our concerns to undercut our resolve to get this issue done, because it is a very tough process. As I indicated earlier to Mr. Leach, I think that if we don't do this, there are problems out there. I can't forecast to you what the short-term problems are, but I certainly know what the long-term problems are. And they clearly are inadequate savings, inadequate investment, inadequate growth and productivity and living standards. And if we find reason after reason not to act, we will end up with the worst of all worlds in that respect.
A question on credit and credit crunch, which you have talked about. I am troubled, as I study the banking industry, in the way credit decisions are made, in the fact that it doesn't seem, and this is to an outside observer, I'm not in the room when they're making these decisions, but it doesn't seem the banks rely on the old fundamentals as much as they used to. Look at the numbers and say, well, we'll lend here, we won't lend there, we'll lend here, we won't lend there. And instead, there seems to be more of a, it's referred to as a herd instinct, and I don't mean that unkindly. I guess it's hard not to mean it unkindly, so let me think of a better word. Sort of a trendiness in banking, as opposed to looking at the fundamentals. One of the things that hit home to me on this, and then I want to relate it to a specific question, when I read about the foibles of Donald Trump, and I saw that two of the smartest banks, or groups that banks that were alleged to be the smartest banks around, had given him large amounts of unsecured loans after others had given him lots of secured loans. This was not recently, but before his trouble began. Also related to this credit issue and how banks make credit decisions is the fact that I hear in my area, just like in Mr. Neal's, that small businesses, I had a small businessman in my district come to me the other day, it's a pretty significant business. He showed me his statements, his profits were as good as last year, his prospects are very good, and his bank just cut him off, a big bank, big New York bank. While I certainly understand, say, in real estate, there has been overbuilding and the banks are serving a very worthwhile function in cutting off credit, small business, it seems to me, these types of small businesses are in as good shape as they ever were, and they're getting credit cut off too. So my question, my fundamental question that underlies all of this is, have banks changed? Has this new free world change the way they make credit decisions? Are they less able to make fundamental credit decisions? Is there more trendiness in this area? Is there anything that can be done about it?
Well, I think to the extent that there was, as you put it, trendiness in the mid-1980s, I think it's back to fundamentals now. And I think one of the things that we are seeing, and one of the elements which I suspect are causing a lot of borrowers great difficulty, is that we're wrenching our way back to what is normal, and in certain respects, as I indicated earlier, I think some have gone over the line, and that there's more retrenchment than is probably desirable for the long-term interests of the particular depository institution. The trouble with lending standards and lending is that it's not easy. It's a very difficult process to try to evaluate what the risks of a particular venture are, and there's no way to avoid that. The banking is an evaluation of risks. And I think that not only do the data and the hard numbers make a difference, but there has always been in banking the issue of the banker's perception of the individual with whom he's dealing. And you know, these wonderful historical anecdotes of banker X lending to a young new entrepreneur strictly on the grounds of he thought the person very capable and was investing in the person, and something great occurred as a consequence of that. That still happens, and I think appropriately so. And it's not a simple numerical activity, and lending activity is partly art form, partly psychologist related.
My worry is that there's more psychology and more art and less numerical, fundamental mathematics than there was 20 years ago.
No, I'm not sure that's true. I think that there may have been less somewhere between 20 years ago and now, but I think now we're okay.
Thank you.
I'd like to recognize Mr. Weiss at this time.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. If I may, Mr. Chairman Greenspan, just follow up on one of the questions that Mr. Schumer asked, recognizing this fine line that you're constantly working between or around as to the dangers of inflation, the dangers of recession, and cognizant of the answer that you gave about the long-term consequences of not bringing the deficit down. What do you say to those economists who argue that as a percentage of GNP, in fact, the deficit is no great shakes, and that the efforts and the concern about the size of the deficit has been overstated, and in fact may, by trying to bring it down, even the 50 or 60 billion that you're talking about, we may in fact be moving toward a recession much more quickly than otherwise would be the case?
Well, first, Mr. Weiss, I think that the issue of the size of the deficit relative to GNP is something which must always be related to the savings rate within an economy. Were our savings rate, say, twice what it currently is, I think we would have very little difficulty with our deficit. The reason we have problems, the reason we find that we have problems in financing it, the reason we are concerned about it, is our savings rate, domestic savings rate, is too low to sustain the level of deficit that we have. We do not have the lowest deficit, the highest deficit as a percent of GNP of the major industrial countries. On the contrary, we're somewhere in the middle to the lower end. But our savings rate is substantially below the average, and the consequence of that means that that deficit has a first claim on domestic savings,
and what's left is clearly inadequate to create enough domestic investment to maintain economic growth, or at least economic growth to which to levels which are desirable. I don't think I'm aware of the people who argue that it's an accounting problem and that we are overemphasizing this issue. I don't want to get into the details of the elements of that argument, merely just to say that I do not agree with it. I think that the deficit is a real problem, that it is has a corrosive effect on long-term economic growth in this country, and that while unquestionably, if we reduce the deficit, we do remove purchasing power from the economy, and other things equal, clearly that would create additional strain. But to the extent that you lower the deficit and it is in fact really reducing purchasing power, not just a paper transaction, it almost surely would also be reducing long-term interest rates, which would galvanize demand in other areas of the economy. And as a consequence of that, it is not clear to what extent the reduction in the deficit is a net reduction in aggregate demand. I'm reasonably certain that a large deficit reduction net on balance will be some reduction in demand, and to that extent, I think the long-term financial markets would respond, and we would probably be responding to the long-term financial markets to try to maintain continued stability in the economy.
I guess implicit in your response also is the expectation that if, in fact, the path that you suggest and suggested of reducing the deficit just right will, in fact, encourage increased savings. But I must tell you, and I have not looked at the numbers, and I don't know the answer, and I ask it of you, but it seems to me that for as long as I've been in this Congress, which is about 14 years, there have been expressions of concern about the fact that we as a society simply do not save, and that we compare ourselves to the Japanese or to the Germans, and we don't save. Now, what is your real-world expectation that, in fact, that's going to turn around, and why do you think that it is going to turn around?
Well, Mr. Weiss, I think you're raising the issue which bedevils economists in this country probably more than any other issue of considerable importance. I would consider that our inadequate savings is the number one long-term problem that this economy has. And while we have engaged upon a number of different tax-related initiatives to try to improve it, it's not clear that they have been very successful. Some have been partly, but there's not been a major change. That's the reason why I have argued that if you cannot increase private savings appreciably, that at least we should reduce the drain on the private savings which the government deficit creates, and even better, to run a surplus in the federal government accounts so that rather than subtracting from domestic savings, one is adding to it and creating a larger pool of savings from which domestic investment can flow, with the consequent improvements in productivity and standards of living.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Chairman, I want to change subject for a moment here. As you know, since our foreign exchange intervention is sterilized, that is to say, its impact on monetary aggregates is offset by open market operations, so that intervention has absolutely no impact on monetary policy, why should the Fed be conducting such intervention at all? That's the first part of the question. And please, I'd like to, if I may, go ahead and finish. I want to add a little something to it before you respond. The point is, why not just let the Treasury do all the intervening out of its exchange stabilization fund? And I mean just out of the exchange stabilization fund's own funds, not using funds obtained from the Federal Reserve through the practice of warehousing, as they do now. The Treasury would then have to come to the Congress to get more funds for the exchange stabilization fund if it wants to go beyond the amount already in that fund. Since intervention is a risky undertaking with potential for losses to the taxpayer, and since its effectiveness is very much in question, in fact, I don't think it's effective at all, shouldn't the Treasury be required to come to the Congress and justify its request to gamble on the foreign exchange markets with additional taxpayers' money? Through its current warehousing arrangements with the Fed, the Treasury has access to funds without any accountability to the Congress and to the American taxpayer. So you can see the question is in several parts, and I'd like to yield to you now for a response.
Well, Mr. Chairman, I think you are raising issues which are very thoroughly debated by economists, international economists, domestic economists. And I think at this particular stage, the consensus, if one can conceivably draw such a notion, is that the evidence is that intervention solely on its own can at best only stabilize short-term situations and does not have a permanent effect on exchange rates. There are nonetheless those, and I must admit many of my colleagues, who believe that it is worthwhile at the margin to do intervention and thereby stabilize to a certain extent the normal volatilities that do exist in exchange rates. They do not, and I do not, perceive it as any sort of speculation. It is an endeavor to add an element of stability to the system. I think that there is a growing awareness that it is far better for central banks to try to move towards a general non-inflationary environment so that the long-term stability of exchange rates is ensured, and then allow that process to be the major factor in stabilizing rates. I think that issue is evolving, but it is still a debatable question as to whether it is strongly useful, marginally useful, or not useful at all. I think at this particular stage, the majorities, if one could put it that way, is that intervention is marginally useful. On the issue of restricting the Treasury from borrowing until they came back, and if they needed additional funds to increase their balances, I would recommend against that on the grounds that to the extent that the activity is pursued at all, it cannot await the process of congressional action to essentially specify more funds. My judgment basically is that the system is working reasonably well. I think that the Federal Reserve should be involved with the Treasury because I think the combination of our consultative activities with respect to those actions, in my judgment, have been helpful rather than hindrance, in the sense that we bring to bear sources of information, not only that those which the Treasury has in its international dealings, but our information, which is collateral information. And even though Treasury takes the lead in the underlying policy with respect to the process, we at the Fed are strongly influential on what actions are taken, when they are taken, and the processes that are involved, such as warehousing or the size of the reserve balances that we build up. So I would suggest to you that many of the issues that you raise are issues which are in current debate, and I think significant debate, but at the moment I would recommend against any substantive change in the process, because in my impression is that it will evolve in a way which will reflect the underlying market forces which we are obviously endeavoring to affect.
Well, what you're saying is that the intervention is only marginally useful, which I agree with, and I guess the argument there would be whether it ought to be done at all in the real world, and you're moving toward that. I couldn't agree with you more that what we ought to do is, in terms of coordination, is each run its own economy in a sensible way, and that would be the best possible coordination. But I'm delighted, I must tell you, that the Treasury is calling on you and your economists and so on for your wisdom in dealing in this area. What my concern goes a bit beyond that, however, is I understand that you have something like $26 billion now of your...
Talking about the Federal Reserve.
Federal Reserve. I didn't mean your pocket change, no, Mr. Chairman. I know you could do it, but as I understand, you have something like $26 billion worth of Federal Reserve money at risk here. Now, I don't... The degree of risk is probably not great, but anyway, it is engaged in this kind of activity, which we both said is of marginal usefulness. It is being done at the request of the Treasury. The Treasury has its own taxpayers' money at risk, and it's at least there's some, ultimately there's a little accountability there, but there's no accountability here at all. And like I say, if it's a marginal utility, I personally don't think it should be done. I know that leaders of governments love to engage in this grand foreign policy strategy and so on and put taxpayers' money at risk doing it, but as I say, I think we ought to put as much limits on that as we can. But beyond that, we have the situation where they are telling you what to do. They're not subject to any oversight, any accountability in this area. You have to do it. And I just, myself, I must say, I think it's a mistake. And I don't think you've fully commented on this aspect of it. You've commented on several important points, but not on this.
Let me say that it's not an issue of the Treasury merely giving us instructions, we being their fiscal agent. In this regard, the actions to engage in foreign exchange trading are implemented at the Federal Reserve Bank of New York, and the instructions that occur are the result of discussions which exist between officers of the Treasury and officers of the Federal Reserve when there are major policy issues that come up with respect to significant changes. The Treasury Secretary and myself discussed them at length, and I do not recall an instance in which we were, in a sense, instructed to do something without our getting one to comment on it and actually to alter its nature. So it is a consultative process, and it is a partnership. And I think it is working reasonably well. I do acknowledge the fact that there are elements of risk involved, but the odds actually favor us in the market, so that what occurs usually is that there is a net profit in the particular process. But even granting that, I think that it is important that we make available, as we do, the full detail of our activities periodically. And I think that we endeavor to make certain that through these reports that the Congress and the public know in detail what it is we are doing.
Mr. Chairman, my time is expiring anyway, and I want to point out, as you probably know, the chairman of the full committee has noticed this activity, and he intends a set of hearings on it, and I know I'll be trying to attend those hearings as well. I hope you all are aware of that and will help us again with your wisdom. I don't think that the public is going to be too happy about the vast amounts of money involved in it. And I think that these hearings will attract more public attention to these activities. And one of the worries that I have along these lines is that it might lead to some remedies that might be not beneficial to the Fed's continuing conduct of its most important responsibilities. That's, you know, one of the recommendations that the hearings will be held on is a scheme to get in and audit the foreign exchange operations, which would lead to an audit of the Open Market Committee operations and so on, which I personally think would be unfortunate, and we'll try to ward off. But again, this is another aspect of it I hope you're fully aware of. And thank you for your comments, Mr. Barnard.
Shifting gears again, Mr. Chairman. Throughout the discussion of the savings and loan and bank failures during the 80s, there has been a criticism of the quality of the bank regulatory and supervisory agencies. Can you give us any encouragement that this has improved?
I mean, whether the supervisory and examination process has improved,
yes.
I would say most certainly.
What changes have taken place to cause that improvement?
I would say the extraordinarily large amount of soured loans, which has not only got the attention of the depository institution, Thrift, but also those involved in examination and oversight. So I'm saying it is, in a sense, an almost automatic response when one is confronted with activities which didn't work and creates problems.
Are you saying
it's normal?
It was done internally within the bank more so than it was done through the supervisory agencies?
You mean the changes?
Uh-huh.
Well, if we're talking about commercial banks, I would say yes. That is, commercial bank in today's environment, confronted with the increasing loan losses that it's had in recent years, has very carefully reevaluated its loan policies and its processes, all to the good, in my view.
When we go back and see some of the reasons for the tremendous failures in banks, do you see that there's any place in the future for credit allocation? In fact, for example, and I'm meaning particularly that a lot of the banks funded these LBOs, and now they are having to extend the loans, they're having to refinance the interest on the loans. Does that cause you some concern that we might need to go to allocation of credit?
I would be most resistant to do that because I think it would be extraordinarily inefficient, and it presupposes that examiners or regulators have greater insight into the risk balance in particular loans than commercial bankers. I would far prefer to allow those judgments of allocation to be made by bankers rather than by examiners, who I do not think
but you know, Congress has taken, but Congress itself has taken note of whether or not that is the best use of bank credit. Do you think then it is Congress's province to give consideration as to where banks should be making their loans?
And obviously, Congress can do what it chooses. I would just merely say, in my judgment, it would be ill-advised.
Mr. Chairman, as a member of the RTC Oversight Board, what is your reaction to the fact that by December we may be having as many as 900 savings and loans in conservatorship being run by the RTC?
My reaction is that that number had better come down sooner rather than later, because the extent to which we in government have to run these institutions is not in the best interest either of the institutions, the financial system, or the economy as a whole. So I should certainly hope that the RTC, whose basic job is to essentially resolve the troubled institutions, do so sooner rather than later.
Are you pleased with the pace of resolution of these problems?
I am at the moment, Mr. Chairman.
Do you not think that we need any particular changes in FIREA to accomplish a more speedy or more efficient resolving of savings and loans?
I don't think so at the moment. I think that we were slow getting up to the starting line, but I think that there's been clear acceleration at this stage. And so far as the speed and pace of resolution, I don't think I envisage the need for any particular legislative initiatives.
Are you in agreement with the current estimates of the additional cost to the RTC, which is now up to around $147 billion?
I believe the estimate that the Secretary of the Treasury testified to was a range of between $90 and $130 billion. Now, that's the cost of the losses since FIREA. It does not include interest, and that's the reason why it is a smaller number than some have employed. But it'll take a while to get firm estimates, and exact estimates will not be known until the assets are sold in the market, rather than merely allowing them to accumulate in receiverships and be priced for purposes of this loss evaluation in a rather approximate way. So we won't really know what the full cost is, but I have seen the estimates that are being made, and the $90 to $130 billion is roughly in the appropriate area.
Do you think that we ought to include this cost on budget?
I think the crucial question is, is the financing of this, of the RTC, does it have similar effects on the economy as regular Treasury financing? And the answer is not quite. There is a big difference between whether or not you raise money in the capital markets and create financial transactions, or whether you raise money in the financial markets to, say, fund military expenditures. One, the first one does not affect savings and investment. The second does. And it is probably likely, as I've testified here before, that the overall rate of interest is probably not materially affected by borrowings to fund the RTC, although the yield spreads between government issues and private issues narrow, in the sense that the U.S. government rates move higher relative to the private rates, but the average interest rate is probably not significantly altered. That is not the case in borrowing for goods and services, so to speak. So in this context, I would be inclined to think of the RTC borrowing as off budget, and especially the case when we consider the working capital requirements of the RTC, if for no other reason than by the way we construct that borrowing, of necessity, every cent is repaid. And so we have a period when Treasury borrowings go up as the working capital goes up, then it goes down when it is liquidated, and I'm concerned not about the going up as much as I am when it's going down, and it makes the deficit appear less than it really is. So in that sense, I would be far more comfortable if the RTC borrowing requirements were kept separate, whether you call it off budget or not as an accounting notion. But clearly, one should separate that in evaluating both the elements involved in the budget summit and in the subsequent recording of our progress towards a balanced budget.
Mr. Hoagland.
Thank you, sir, very much.
I'd like to ask you a question, if I might, Mr. Chairman, about service sector price inflation. On page 3 of your statement, you notice that it has shown little sign of abating. As I understand it, senior administration officials talking about the desirability of lower interest rates have on several recent occasions suggested that monetary policy is not an effective tool for combating inflation in the service sector. What is your view as to the merit of those arguments?
I disagree with that point of view. I think the way in which monetary policy affects service prices is usually through the wage component. And to the extent that monetary policy slows unit costs in general, but very specifically the growth in unit labor costs, then it will feed over into service prices. It is certainly the case that goods prices have been have shown far less increase than service prices, in large part because there is an additional element involved in goods prices, namely the competition from abroad and the significant increase in import competition, which has tended to lower the general rate of increase in goods prices. In a way, it works through, in part at least, improving productivity or inducing improved productivity in the United States, where that clearly is of only marginal significance with respect to service prices. But since there is a single labor market, the competition that exists between service prices or the service sector and the goods sector of the economy inevitably
induces a spillover from the restraining inflationary effects in goods onto services, as well as the basic direct effect of monetary policy on wage inflation and hence prices. So overall, while it may appear to be slower working or have certain different characteristics from goods pricing, service prices do respond to monetary policy, and indeed our view is that we look at the aggregate price level as the crucial element involved in the economy, because it is the aggregate price level which basically affects risk premiums in financial markets. It is the aggregate price level which creates degree of instability or lack thereof in the investment markets, I mean capital investment, and that we should not be separating from purposes of monetary policy endeavor to suppress inflationary pressures in the goods markets as distinct from the service markets.
Let me, if I might, ask you a question about international capital flows. One risk of United States becoming a large debtor nation in our global economy is that we may lose control of our own monetary policy because of international capital flows. If in the next 12 months inflation is stable at 4%, but the economy weakens further, and let's say you and your colleagues decide to ease, isn't it possible that any addition to the reserves would be offset or could be offset by capital flowing out of the United States because interest rates are higher elsewhere and the dollar is perceived weak? I wonder what your policy alternatives are in that scenario.
Well, I don't think there's any question that as the globalization of monetary policy increases, that we at the Federal Reserve and our colleagues in the other central banks find that we must increasingly react to international forces. And to that extent, there is an element of lesser control, but it's not a major issue. It's actually quite minor. It nonetheless does underscore the need for central bankers to coordinate, as we do. We meet periodically to exchange views on policies and try to, where appropriate, endeavor to coordinate. But while there are problems, and I think you correctly identify the nature of where the problems are coming from, I would scarcely argue that it undercuts the Federal Reserve's ability to do the job we were required to do.
Well, have there been any periods since you've been chairman where your moves have been offset or partially offset by international capital flows? And if there were any such periods, is there any specific action you took about that?
I don't think so. In other words, the trouble, unfortunately, is in many respects our knowledge of capital flows is late. I mean, we don't get the data as rapidly in full detail as one would like to make the types of judgment you suggest, Mr. Hoagland. But I think that our knowledge of those flows in a very general way is adequate for the purposes of monetary policy domestically.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Mr. McCollum.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. I'm sorry I couldn't have been around here for all of the questioning this morning. I had to have a markup in another committee. But I know you're asked inevitably questions, and I've heard you were again this morning about the budget and the deficits and questions, of course, that should be asked here about the M's, M1, M2, M3, and all the factors that go into monetary policy. I guess I have a sort of a bottom line question after all is said and done. And it isn't one to ask you what you're going to do, which I don't think you should be answering, and you won't in here. But every time that we get into these discussions, I guess somebody comes off and he's a reporter and he writes, as I mentioned in my opening comments to you, Chairman Greenspan said so-and-so, and they run off and they put that on the wires. And a few minutes later, something else. I never know which one it is they think is important. And they write off and say another one. Is there anything that you see on the blip screen other than your comments that you made earlier in your written testimony and so on that would lead you to believe that the economy is not generally in pretty good shape? I mean, are things going generally in the right direction?
Well, Mr. McCollum, I think that we clearly have a sluggish economy, one which is growing more slowly than it has in the past. And that, in part, is a function, as I indicated in my prepared testimony, of a surprising slowdown in the labor force. To the extent that one can evaluate the quality of an economy, it's clearly better than it was in the sense that we do not have the frenetic credit expansion nor double-digit money supply growth. It's a more measured change that's occurring in the expansion of the financial system, and that is gradually improving some of the balances in our financial system, which I have in past testimonies here been concerned about. In other words, the increased leveraging of the corporate sector, the effect that has on the ratio of interest payments to corporate cash flow, the various elements within the banking system and its problems. All of these issues are likely to be ameliorated, at least in part, by this gradual reduction in gross credit expansion and monetary growth. And in that sense, I'm feeling somewhat more comfortable about the broad underlying base of the economy. It is nonetheless true that the economy is not vibrant. It's not moving forward in a very rapid pace. I'm not sure, considering the fact that we have a 5.2% unemployment rate, that that's all bad.
And so say you'd be a little worried if it were right now, I would think.
The what?
You'd be a little bit worried if the economy suddenly were bursting forward at this point.
No, I would. I would say that were that the case, I think it would create some very considerable difficulties for us.
Inflationary difficulties,
yes.
In particular.
And I would, I don't want to hypothecate all the various different things that can happen from here, but I think we've come a long way without the economy tilting into recession. And in that process, I think that we have ameliorated a number of the imbalances, not all, but a number of the imbalances which were engendered during the mid-1980s.
Well, I know that you'd like to get to zero inflation someday, as Mr. Neal would like to, and I think everybody would in principle. But I gather from your comments that, generally speaking, that the policies that you've had, that you've seen implemented, and what is going on in the economy today kind of mesh with at least the concept that, for the moment, inflation is steady. It's not out of control. It is under control. It could be better, but it is, in light of the sluggishness in the economy, I assume, around where at the better end of your expectations for the present period.
No, I wouldn't quite say that. I would say that, as I've indicated to you before, we think the inflation rate is higher currently than we would like. We do, however, believe that with the changes in the rate of growth of the overall credit variables, and more specifically, the money supply rates of growth that have occurred in the last several years, plus what we envisage for the future, that rate will come down. We don't like to see it where it is, because it is very easy to accelerate from here, as I've indicated to this committee on many occasions in the past, and we would be far, far better off at a significantly lower rate, ideally to a non-inflationary rate, whether that is literally zero or a small plus, I don't think is all that relevant, so long as we effectively remove the expectations of inflation as a significant factor from business decision making.
And your objective, of course, is to slowly and gradually get there, which is without unduly disrupting the economy, which is essentially the path you describe we're on, except that you think the economy is a little more sluggish than you'd like. So obviously you really don't want us to be getting there quite, in other words, in too draconian a fashion. If you can get too sluggish to get there is what I'm suggesting.
Well, we are trying to balance the various forces in the economy, recognizing that they interact in a manner in which the correct policy, if one could find such a policy, will create not only the best inflation environment, but as a consequence of that, the maximum potential long-term growth as well.
I thank you, Mr. Chairman, and I thank you, Mr. Neal.
Thank you, sir. Mr. Sherman.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. My first question relates, we had talked about before the bad lunch, we talked about the effects of recession on New England. New England had such low growth. The West Coast seems to have very high growth, 4.5%. My question is our economy becoming more regionalized? I don't recall a time when there seemed to be such disparities in different ways in the last while. Have things changed so that we're going to live with most of the time one part of the economy in recession, another part of the economy in boom, and then other parts in degrees in between? Is that more prevalent now than it was 15 or 20 or even 10 years ago?
I haven't looked at the data in any systematic way, Mr. Schumer, but I would suspect not. I mean, remember that in 1986 or 85, 86, 86 really, the spread between New England and Southwest right. was about as large as I remember.
I don't mean in the last 2 years, but I mean in the last decade, in the last 15, in the last 20.
Well, in principle, if you go back long enough, clearly it couldn't be the case, because obviously the in the 1850s, for example, California was wholly dissociated as far as economic activity was concerned from the East, and one would have expected rather significant differences. I don't really, I mean, obviously at some point it may have turned around. I'm not sufficiently familiar with it, but I would not necessarily argue that there is increased regionalization. One would assume actually otherwise as a consequence.
You'd think so. That's why I find it so funny.
Communication and transportation.
Yeah. Second question relates to income distribution. Kevin Phillips' book has taken this town by storm, and he, in his book, talks about how the middle class economically and in other ways is getting squeezed. In the 80s, the well-to-do, the very wealthy did much better. Do the numbers that you have bear that out? In other words, that in the 80s, the middle income people lost proportionately compared to the, say, top 1% of the population. Secondly, does it have effects for the economy? I know many economists, or at least some, believe that the Great Depression, in a sense, was caused by the fact that wealth became too concentrated in the upper reaches in the late 20s. There wasn't enough money in the rest of society, and when a downturn occurred, it just kept going down and down and down.
I don't know how to answer that question specifically. See if you can rephrase it for me.
Well, the first part is in the 80s. The first one you could answer specific. The first part of the question was, do your numbers, do the Federal Reserve Board's numbers?
Yeah, I'm trying to, that's where my problem is. We don't have Federal Reserve Board numbers.
On income distribution?
No. These are Census Bureau data.
God.
The data that we have are really secondary source data.
And not to be trusted.
And I wouldn't want to, you know.
Well, what's your view? Well, okay, well, not speaking as chairman.
The reason I'm having a problem with this question is that.
You haven't had problems with very many.
Well, I understand that. But
this one wasn't intended to be a difficult one.
No. It is a difficult one because I haven't looked at these data in adequate detail in recent years. And while I grant you I am aware of Kevin Phillips' remarks and I am aware of what other people are saying about this issue, I hesitate at this point to come to any conclusions because my recollection of the data is that there are very substantial amounts of interpretation required to draw various different conclusions. So I'm trying essentially to avoid an answer from largely because I'm uncomfortable with the data themselves, and I'm trying to remember myself what the shortfalls in the data are, and I'm having difficulty recollecting at this stage.
I'd be happy to yield to
I'm sort of curious, too. If, let's say that we had absolutely perfect data that suggested that the top 1% of our society controlled roughly the same amount of financial assets as the bottom 40%, would that be troubling?
Well, I think that there are obviously effects when you have very sharp differences in distribution of either income or wealth, largely because it tends to fragmentize the markets. That is, you don't get large big consumer markets for specific goods, leaving the equity issue aside. And my impression, basically, is that it does create some difficulties. On the other hand, it is also the case that large distributions of income do create probably a higher savings rate than would ordinarily occur in a society. And other things equal, and I emphasize other things equal, that's a positive element. So as far as the functioning of the economy is concerned, I think that it is difficult to make a judgment as to whether maldistributions of income or wealth net on balance have significant negative impacts upon the economy. And one thing I'm reasonably sure of is one cannot attribute the 1929-1932 contraction to that. There may be effects, and I think there are people who do argue there are effects. I find the evidence myself, or at least I've found it over the years, inconclusive either way, wholly independent of the equity question. And I would not want to argue that certainly monetary policy shouldn't be responding to this because I'm not sure which direction we respond.
Yeah. Let me just say, just comment? You are commenting clearly in terms of the overall economic effect of such a maldistribution of wealth. And, of course, we have to be concerned with issues other than that also. But I just want, even on those grounds, it strikes me as strange that our savings rate is so bad. In fact, as you pointed out earlier, even in relationship to our major trading partners, it's among the worst in the country. And yet, I imagine that the maldistribution of wealth here is probably more pronounced than it is in most of the other countries that we're comparing ourselves to.
Mr. Chairman, I would say that the distribution of income and wealth is only one element in the savings equation.
Well, you mentioned it. That's why I'm pursuing this.
But it is, in other words, but in evaluating a specific economy, it's important to take, you know, look at both sides of the issue. The differences between economies with respect to culture, attitudes, and the like are far more important elements in defining the difference in the underlying savings rate than, as best I can judge, distribution of income and wealth.
I thank the gentleman for yielding. I just...
Well, thank you. I am surprised, though, that the Fed doesn't have data on the distribution levels.
We've got data from the Bureau of the Census. It's not our information.
Right.
We do not do anything separately in that respect, except we do have a survey of consumer finances in which, as part of it, we do collect income by income class, but that's nowhere near as good as... The underlying data which Census uses.
On the question of the savings rate, which is a conversation that you and I have had, an ongoing one for a year or two, I'm becoming more and more convinced that the answer of why we save so little is sort of the opposite side of the coin, that America has become the greatest merchandiser around, that we are the best far and away. How are we different than the Germans, the Japanese, and God knows everyone else? We can sell a product better than any of them, with television and everything else. And I think we've sort of encouraged, because of our merchandising bent, we've sort of encouraged our people, our government, our businesses, all of them, in a sense, you know, to have a dollar's worth of life on 90 cents worth of income, if you will. Now, I don't know what you do with that. I mean, maybe you give preferential advertising rates to banks. I don't know, you know. That is a facetious suggestion. But, we've looked at all the tax benefits and we've talked about those. We've looked at IRAs. We've looked at all the various things, and they may make some marginal difference. But I agree with you. It's the number one question for the American economy. It's the number one reason that the Japanese say buy Rockefeller Center or the British buy whatever they buy. And yet we can't seem to change it. We're sort of locked in and no one even has suggestions about what to do about it. So that's where my thinking has evolved.
Congressman, I couldn't agree with you more. I think it is very frustrating and... it's a very crucial issue which we cannot merely set aside for another day. We've got to keep pursuing this issue, try to find a means to resolve it. We don't have the choice not to.
Isn't it clear, though, that our tax laws especially encourage consumption and discourage savings? And, I mean, we do a lot of those things in the name of consumers, but in the macroeconomic terms, the net effect of it is to discourage saving. And also, when you compare our saving rate with that of Japan, there are some significant differences. We have a much higher developed social security system than do the Japanese, which, as I understand it, says to our people, you don't have to save as much for old age as maybe a Japanese person understands about his or her future. Isn't that correct? I'm not an expert on this, but I understood that some of these things make a big difference. Also, I'd also point out to my friend that, as I understand the way our economy works, there's hardly anything that encourages savings more than to know that the value of the savings will remain constant, that is, zero inflation. Now, I had an interesting experience many years ago. I was in China before the so-called normalization of relations between our countries, and the Chinese, under this rigid communist system, were very proud of the fact that the value of their currency had not changed in decades. I can't remember exactly what they were saying, and they absolutely controlled it. And it was a promise, it was one of the promises that they had made to their own people, that their currency wouldn't change in value. And the Chinese, the, I guess among the most poverty-stricken of all people in the world, saved. On their meager incomes, they saved because they knew the value would remain constant. And Let me tell you another little sideline that I found very amusing. I'll tell you how strictly they enforce this. My son was young at the time and collected coins. And when I was leaving the country, another thing that they were very proud of was that there was essentially no crime, and that we would leave our hotel rooms open, and then it would be no worry about that. And so anyway, I was ready to change the money back, except I wanted to keep a few coins and bills and so on to bring home to my son. And the money changer there in the lobby saw that and made the change for me, and I didn't say anything, and I took the coins and bills back and put them in my suitcase. And when I got home back to the United States, those coins and bills weren't there. And they had an absolute rule that they were going to protect the value of their currency, which meant protecting the supply of it, controlling the supply of it. They had a rule against taking coins and currencies out of the country, and I guess they knew I was prepared to commit this great crime, so they went in there and got them. Now, anyway, does the gentleman have further questions or comments?
I was just going to say that this is why I guess we don't get anywhere on the savings issue. Mr. Neal thinks that the zero inflation bill would do it, and I think abolishing advertising or something would do it. There must be some truth in between. I had one more question, but if there's no time,
there's
another one a little bit far afield.
Well, let me go to Mr. Hogan. I'll come back.
No, I'm sorry.
It's
far afield.
I just have a couple of quick ones, if I may. Mr. Chairman, what would happen if, back to this question of the foreign exchange intervention, what would happen if you just stopped, if there just weren't any more?
Well, we substantially stopped the intervention during the early part of the 1980s.
Was there any harm?
There have been innumerable periods when we have stopped.
Is there any harm done by that?
There are those who think that there was, yes. But this is part of this, Mr. Chairman, is part of the ongoing debate. In fact, we at the Fed, a number of months ago, had a very elaborate evaluation and discussion amongst the participants of the FOMC on very many of the points which you raise. And it is interesting to see that there are differences, legitimate differences, which still fairly markedly occur.
I don't want to pursue this too much, but just in your own opinion, I'm just curious, what if we stop, would there be any great damage done?
What if we did not intervene?
Right, just stop doing it.
My own personal view is that the advantages of intervention are relatively limited. And I do think there are some occasions when I think it probably is helpful to intervene, but I would probably, on the scale of what my colleagues think, I would probably be more towards the less rather than more intervention area.
I have just one final question, if I may. Let me direct your attention to the chart, which I know you have on the table there. It's entitled Bank Reserves and Federal Funds. I think it's the one right to your right there. And what is interesting to note is that the Fed funds rate has remained pretty stable over this year, and that the reserves have come down. And that leads me to think that the emphasis is on maintaining a federal funds rate, stability, or maintaining the federal funds within some range of stability. And it seems to me that we engaged in a magnificent experiment in this country, and under the leadership of Chairman Volcker, that was successful. It seems to me that he demonstrated conclusively that you can control inflation by controlling the monetary aggregates, and he did it. It was a shame that we had let inflation go to the point that it took so much disruption in the economy to do it, but in any case, he did it, and he, I think, saved the country. And as you know, I've complimented you many times on your leadership at the Fed, because you're continuing to target inflation and control it. It's such a great, does such great harm to our country. But I just wonder if you would help clarify, at least my own thinking. It appears to me that there is some emphasis here on the federal funds rate again, that that if that is so, it would be troubling to me. It would indicate that we're moving away from controlling the aggregates, controlling inflation, to trying to accomplish something else, which might lead us down a dangerous road again.
Mr. Chairman, I think that we look at the purpose of monetary policy to affect financial elements within the system. Very specifically, we target M2, M3, and the credit aggregate. And we are very careful to observe the interrelationship between various different levels of the federal funds rate and the movements in these other aggregates, which obviously is where the overall long-term effects, as well as some short-term effects, occur. So while it is certainly the case that on a day-by-day basis we are acutely aware of what the federal funds rate is, we are not wedded to that in the sense that that's all we do. What we are very acutely aware of is what a funds rate is doing to the credit aggregates, to money supply, and indeed it's exactly that issue which created a response on our part a couple of weeks ago, when in effect we were getting a response different from that which we had intended, and that did require an adjustment in the federal funds rate in order to keep the other elements in the system on the tracks that we wanted, which as we view it, fundamental thrust of monetary policy.
Well, I don't know whether you're encouraging this or whether it's something that is just inevitable. If it is, I don't quite understand why. But there is certainly, in the financial press, it seems to me, an emphasis on the federal funds rate that I don't know how useful it is. I mean, it's a free country, and we can write about whatever they want. But it would seem to me that if you talk more about these other elements of monetary policy, that it might focus public attention more on that, and with the result that the public would have a more accurate understanding of what's really going on. Is that right or not?
Well, I think you may be raising an interesting issue. Let me think about that. Our job, as the public sees it, seems complicated enough. I don't want to make it appear to be utterly abstruse.
That wasn't my intention either. It just seemed to me that there's a greater likelihood of misunderstanding with all the attention on the federal funds rate than if the attention was
well, I think
on
it's
the longer
a
term.
Colloquy such as we're having, Mr. Chairman, in which we can make our views of this these elements better known, but I will certainly take under advisement your notions, which I think it's an interesting issue.
Thank you. Mr. Hoagland.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'd just like, Mr. Chairman, to ask you three more questions, if possible, and I know we're holding you well into the lunch hour, but the information that you give us is so interesting and important that I will try and make these as quick as I can. First, Mr. Schumer's question that he was unable to answer because he had to leave, which he also said was somewhat far-fetched, I think is very much worth putting to you in light particularly of our situation in Omaha, where our unemployment rate is so low now that we're actually losing businesses that are considering locating in Omaha but going elsewhere because they're not the labor market.
And that is immigration any kind of a solution to our labor shortage problems in parts of the country? Do you see opening our gates a little wider, particularly in light of the talent in Eastern Europe and the Soviet Union that would like very much to come here, as helping our economy, as something you would recommend?
Well, it's scarcely in the area of Federal Reserve interests, but it is nonetheless the case that we are looking at a labor force growth which seems inordinately slow. Granted, the last 6 months are probably a temporary aberration, but even having said that, it does look as though the extraordinary growth in female participation in the labor force, which had been a major factor in the net addition to the labor force, is beginning to slow its pace in one form or another. And obviously, immigration can offset that. I mean, it's immigration, obviously, of skilled workers and those in the various age and cohort categories which are major participants in the labor force. There's no question that certainly our history underscores the extraordinary contribution that immigration has made to our economic vitality and growth. Should we begin to become concerned about an inadequate labor force growth, which in turn creates, in a broad policy sense, an inadequate economic growth potential, then clearly one should evaluate this issue, because it makes a obvious difference in the outcome.
Can immigration involve enough numbers of peoples to make a significant impact? And
as far as I understand it, the United States still attracts vast quantities of people who would be delighted to come to our shores and participate in what they perceive as unbelievable prosperity.
And such talented people too. We have available now. The FOMC in its mid-year review raised the estimate of inflation for the current year compared with the February estimate, which means that for about 2 years now we've been having trouble with inflation, as I understand it. And at the same time, our economy seems to be performing below what the Fed considers to be non-inflationary potential real growth of about 2.5%. What are your thoughts as to, and I know you've addressed this subject before this morning repeatedly, but I wonder if you might be able to capsulize for us how you might approach dealing with the problem of having inflation somewhat higher than we would like, having growth somewhat lower than we would like.
Well, I think the solution to that is clearly a lower budget deficit, because to the extent that the budget deficit comes down in a significant way, I would suspect real long-term interest rates will fall accordingly, and that would create an increased mix towards capital investment, presumably productivity-inducing capital investment, and that would be a major factor in bringing our growth rate up from its current sluggish levels.
Now, I've missed some of your earlier testimony. Do you agree that the summit target of $50 to $55 billion in deficit reduction is the appropriate?
I think that's the appropriate order of magnitude, all things considered, 50 to 55, 50 to 60, somewhere in that area.
Okay. Now, Mr. Chairman, on previous occasions, we've talked about my mother and her
interests. I remember.
And she recently has been asking me about the risk of a debt liquidation cycle. And she reads that junk bonds have been marked down in price, that SNL assets are going to be sold at big discounts by the RTC, real estate prices are falling in several parts of the country, And there is even a question about government support for some agency securities which are not full faith and credit obligations of the U.S. government. Total debt is now about 1.8 times the size of GNP, at least in 89 it was, which is way above past levels. This all has meaning in the Midwest, in Omaha. How can we bring individual corporate and government debt levels down without encouraging the harsh consequences of a debt liquidation panic, she wants to know.
Congressman, I had no difficulty, even with my little colloquy with Representative Schumer, on answering questions at this panel. Your mother is creating a problem for me. In all seriousness, though, I think that these are hypothetical types of events. We can set up all different forms of scenarios of concerns that we have. Fortunately, the vast majority of the concerns that we have don't materialize. I do think it's important for us to focus on getting the budget deficit down in a stable monetary environment, and much of those other distortions which are created by inflationary processes generally, I think, would be significantly subdued. We do have a very dynamic economy. Lots of things happen, and while most of it is good, there are clearly negatives that are occurring all the time. And I think one of the great things about a market economy is it is a self-curing process. And what I think policy is for government is to create the environment which enables the markets to work most efficiently to do that.
Well, thank you for your patience and for giving us as much time this morning as you have.
And my regards to your mother.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I will pass that on.
I want to invite your mother to come testify one of these days. I think that she might be the only person that I'm aware of who could equal the distinguished chairman of the Federal Reserve Board and the previous chairman of the Federal Reserve Board in confusing members of this panel.
I can assure you, Mr. Chairman, if she comes to testify, I'll come into the audience and watch.
Right. Learn a few lessons. Mr. Chairman, thank you for being with us this morning. The subcommittee stands adjourned, subject to the call of the chair.